I'm a parallel entrepreneur, a three-book author, and a professional speaker on outlier marketing. Two of my books are on marketing strategy specific to a target segment. One is for startups called Outlier Marketing, and the next one is for an even closer segment of professional speakers on how to get their first paid speech and move it across. My companies are in healthcare research, a management consulting specific to marketing, a call center by and for people with disabilities, and an investment in a cheese making company. Every year I invest in a company, every other year I fail. This year the newer investment is in a card game company that's coming out with a card game called Maja to teach four important marketing concepts through playing a rummy style game. Next year, we're coming out with a card game on business persona for a particular company or a startup. How do we come up with? So that is who I am, and that's what I do. From a contribution perspective, I'm extremely active in Thai. I've taken a few sessions for IIT. I'm a part of the Ascent Foundation group of companies. I'm on the governing council there. I used to interact a lot with startups. Now, most of my interaction is in growth companies and their startup divisions, right? So that's who I am. Today I'm here to talk only about three questions. Where can I find my customer? How many customers are there? And how many do I need? I have studied a bit about your company details, what was provided by Padma. So there's an even split between students who are appearing as well as startups. Whether also a storyteller. And I'm going to start off with a favorite story of mine. All of us have studied in school, and in all sections there's always this one person who's extremely notorious, naughty, always getting caught, always being pulled up by the principal. Let's call him Anand. Now this is a village about 40 kilometers out of Chennai. Anand is extremely naughty and he's always around surrounded by two or three of his people. One day the principal calls everybody and says, you have 1 week, I'm giving you this assignment, you will have to display your project in the assembly room 1 week from now. So all the studious ones quickly got it done the next 24-48 hours. The vast majority did it with a day to spare. Now two of Anand's friends were completely irritated, nothing was done. So they went straight to Anand saying, boss, tomorrow we have to submit. What have you done? He said, I haven't done anything. But the principal is going to ask. I said, doesn't matter. Go and get three goats. So his friends didn't understand, but they just followed through, went and picked up three goats. Anand numbered them, took them to the school, opened all the classroom doors, let the goats loose, closed the school door and came out. Next morning, 8 o'clock, Anand and his two friends get in near the school, complete chaos and pandemonium. Goats running across, goat shit here, students jumping, teachers frustrated, all of them searching for the goats. 10 o'clock, they find three goats, but the search is still on. The principal gets frustrated and says, I'm postponing the demonstration by one more week. And till 1:32, they continued to search for a goat. Do you know what happened? Anand had numbered the goats 1, 2 and 4. So the entire school was searching for the missing goat number 3. What is the pertinence to us as entrepreneurs here? That all through we continue to look for the missing goat and we forget what we have in our hands. I am an outlier marketer. And as an outlier marketer, I use things that are inside me, around me, and accessible to me to go ahead and further my business. I can sit around clearly and say, if only I had. Right? I call that the if only I had syndrome. If only I had more time, if I only had more data, if only I had a lot more money, time and resources, I would do it. Those are for whiners who are not entrepreneurs. As entrepreneurs, as outlier marketers, we find out a way and execute in however little information that is there. As entrepreneurs, welcome to the world of ambiguity. If you're expecting clear-cut decisions, things that you have to do, go take up a job. But since you've already committed here, especially for the students, let me also set an authority here, guys. When I started my career, I was 21 and I set myself a goal that by the time I was 30, I would have crossed 25 countries. I crossed 30 countries, and it was possible only because I was an entrepreneur. Now I'm a professional speaker, and I have a goal of speaking in 100 countries. Professional speaker means you are fully paid to go and speak, and I've spoken in 26 countries. That's also possible because I'm an entrepreneur, and I've got multiple companies that gives me the freedom to go ahead and do what I want. Right? I take a vacation every single month from 2016. Every single month, I take 4 to 5 days off. Right? So we can whine about it, or we can pick it up and get things done. I will jump straight in. Let's first break some myths. Everyone is my client. My product will be bought by everybody. All these are absolute myths that we would need to throw in. I will question from the very basic, how many clients do we need? How many clients do we need? The army case is completely different. There, of course, if you are managing to sell it inside India, there is a potential for you to sell it way outside, but we will come to that in a bit. What is your business, sir? Right. Are you already in production? Are you in prototype?
Prototype.
Right. Do you know the difference between a POC and a prototype? We use the words interchangeably as we use marketing and sales.
Proof of concept is a paper. Prototype is something
good.
More than a paper.
POC good, is a
good line.
Form of the product.
Good line of thinking.
POC can be based on analysis and simulations also.
Absolutely.
Experimental.
A POC, if you ask me, is more internal. A prototype is for external view. So internally, we will know if everything works. But then you put it together as a demonstration. So it's idea, POC, prototype, then version one of the product. Right. So who is your typical customer?
It would be the manufacturing companies who has a workforce of more than 100 or 150.
Beautiful. Nice. Can you give me some examples?
Sundaram Plastics, Lucas Digius.
Beautiful. Have you approached any of them already?
Yeah.
Right. What is the status?
They have asked us to do a proof of concept for them.
Okay. Have they given it in writing?
Not yet.
How many customers do you need? Let me correct my lingo here. My opinion and how I use it, clients are B2B, customers are B2C. That is just my definition that's held me in good stead for 20 years. So there is no ambiguity in what we are talking about. Those who are focusing on B2C, look at customers. Those who look at B2B, look at clients. You start with one client. Even if you have one idea, all you need at this state is that one client who bites in. And I'm talking to you as a practitioner here. I'm not a lecturer, I'm not a professor, I'm a practicing entrepreneur. All the companies that I've had a success with, it started with one company and me getting 1 crore in the first year. All the companies that we have failed, where we did it in reverse, that we developed a solution and then searched for a market, it failed. I've lost several lakhs there. I will continue to, but there has to be a method to the madness. So if you have an idea, the first thing you need to do is get somebody to commit in writing. Because we all easily get fooled in terms of taking in only what we want to hear, which is only positive news. Right? So any startup that comes to me for guidance gets ragging 101 right there. If he or she is serious, he comes for the second meeting. Otherwise, it's time savings for me. Because most of the folks who are wannabe entrepreneurs only want to hear good news. I just want to hear that you like my idea, you concur with my idea. Therefore, hey, he said my idea is good. But who the hell is he? Is he the one who's going to sign the check? So you need to get that part absolutely clear in your mind. And that is coming from me as a practicing entrepreneur and investor. Yes, sir.
When you say letter, does it mean letter of interest or is it a bounding kind of
thing? No, it is a letter of interest. Come on, if I don't know you, I can say, yes, good idea, come to me later. Right? But that doesn't hold good. If I am serious, I will say, boss, I give it to you in writing that I am seriously interested in it. So when you come back with the POC, this is the next step that we will go ahead and take. Right? You might say it is only an idea. Well, you will need to fine-tune that particular idea. Right? And it does not need to be an original idea. Boy meets girl, boy fights with girl, boy falls in love with girl, boy gets married. Right? Then you add screenplay associated with it. Right? That the girl's parents did not like it. he met with an accident, had amnesia, whatever. All that is a part of screenplay. But how you present the idea and what is it that is going to be. And I'm going to continue from what Kumar said earlier, a bit later, but how many clients do you need? You just need one to start with. And this is for your pitch, for your business, it doesn't matter where it is going to be, because if you are already in the pitch stage, that means you will necessarily need to have something significant going on. You are not, if you're going to sell gas, forget about it. And at this point, I will put a hat tip to Professor J.K. Iyer. He's not a professor anymore, but I've attended several of his sessions, and it is my lucky privilege to speak before him. And you will know why lucky after he speaks. Good.
So you're missing out the slides, I think.
I don't use slides. That's just my talking notes. I try to avoid slides as much as possible because I'm a very selfish speaker. I want all the attention to myself. Or in terms of the worksheet that has been provided to you. Okay. Let me ask you a question, sir. And the solitary lady here, I don't know if both of you are participating in it. Let's say I make a killing this year and I have 10 lakhs additional income to spare. And I give the 10 lakhs to my wife. She decides to purchase jewelry. Right? She goes to Thangamalika here, GR, Thangamalika, GRT. Who's the competition now? Who's the competition for GRT?
Tanishq.
Good. Good.
Joy Lucas.
Lovely. As you work on your idea, take a step back and evaluate. She's got 10 lakhs to spend. She can go take a foreign junket. She can buy a Gucci, Prada, whatever. She can buy a Kate Spade handbag. She may even donate it. So who is the competition for GRT today? It is the mind share and wallet share of where this money can be spent. So when you're looking at your potential client, you will also need to figure out and understand, move it back as to who is your market here. GRT may say, I'm fighting with jewelry. Why do you think the Diamond Association is issuing so many ads that diamonds are forever that you would need to? Because they are trying to create that entire market as the top of mind aspect, right? Let me ask another question here. You, sir, give me a toothpaste brand.
Colgate.
Lovely. Give me another one.
Excellent.
Another one.
Glister.
Good. The reason I'm asking him is, he goes to buy, the likelihood that he's going to buy choice number one or choice number two is extremely high because that is there in the subconscious top of mind. He goes to shop, those two are not there, he's going to change the shop. So as you are pitching, you will need to figure out, am I going to be top of mind when that comes through? Which leads me to a significant aspect. There's this sheet that's been given to you. And it's absolutely important for you if you have not done it. Have you already worked out on your buyer persona? Who's buying it? Right? You spoke about pain points, sir. There's the other company that... Can somebody talk about pain points of your customers, your clients in this case, B2B? Why should they buy your product? You say you're providing a benefit. I'll say you are addressing a pain point for that particular client. What is the pain point that you are addressing? Anybody?
For us, it was like delay in. So there are golden hours when somebody is injured, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if I have the information, which I can, wherein the person might have died because he didn't have got the proper treatment.
Lovely. How many army commanders did you interview to validate whether it is a pain point that they're looking out for a solution for? Or is your solution based on an assumption that there is a need?
There is an assumption.
Assumption. Good. Anybody else has any other pain points? Yes, go ahead.
Human risk in warehouses.
Beautiful. How did you research that?
We asked a few people who work in warehouses and a few warehouse owners.
Okay. Did you look at a Google search?
Yes, first we did.
First you did. What was the search string that you did? What were the keywords? And I'm coming as to why you would need to. When you analyze that, you will realize which aspect of the pain point are they coming in for. What is the frequency of questions that are being asked in that point? And how do you intend to address that pain point? Right? Now, you have a sheet in front of you. Pick up a client. Now, hold on. Before you, you got the client name. You said Sundaram Fasteners. Who is the decision maker there? Right? Are you sure the plant head is the only decision maker?
No.
Right. Now, I go to a pharmacy and buy Amritanjan. Who am I? Good. I go to the pharmacy and buy Amritanjan for my daughter who is sick. So who is she? I go to the pharmacy and buy Amritanjan for my daughter because my wife said so. So who is she? She is the decision maker. There is another user and there is somebody called a buyer. So if you say it's only going to be plant head, sir, you will need to think wider as to who is the decision making panel in that company, and you need to start writing a little bit more about it. Now, I told you I'm a professional speaker. Who is my target market? My target market is the committee that takes a decision. My target market is other speakers who are going to refer me into speaking positions. My target market is the audience of my audience. What do I mean by audience of my audience? I told you I'm an outlier marketer, I'm a storyteller. You are my audience, but you are going to go talk about me and outlier marketing to your folks. So you see how I'm segmenting? This is just from me as a professional speaker. What is it for you, sir? It's not just Sundaram Fastener plant head. It is the entire decision-making aspect. Is this clear to you? I would need you to take 5 minutes, pick up a particular persona. It could be a plant head, it could be the procurement head, it could be human resources if that comes through. And let us work through the persona here. Padma, do you have one more copy of this? Thank you. Right. So you go ahead, give that designation a name. This is something that I diligently request you to do across each of these personas, not more than 4 or 5 from your decision-making perspective. You will ideally know what the age is going to be. Put an age band around. What is the likely income? What is the job title designation for this? What is the situation that needs to be resolved? End of the day, guys, is it a need or a want? I presume you are absolutely familiar with the difference between the two. The need is for us to dress. The want is how you want to dress. All of them. Right. Any doubts?
What is a persona?
A persona is something that you define. For example, in his case, Sundaram Fasteners plant head. Let's give him a name, Rajesh. Right? What are the characteristics of Rajesh? How long does he work? What does he have to take decisions on? What are his pain points? Right? The minute you put a name, and sometimes you also add an image, everything kind of falls into place. No, what is he asking Google? Because if he or she has a problem, Google is going to be the second or third port of call. In certain cases, first, but in Sundaram Fasteners, it's most likely going to be second. Fair enough? Why am I talking about it? Because all your solutions are modern. All your solutions are talking about robotics and AI. Nobody is going to ask another person. The first port of call is Google. So it is necessary for you to find out what are the questions being asked, what is the frequency of the questions, how applicable are those questions to the pain point that you claim to solve. Because that's not a part of what I'm telling. Your part of reaching out to all of them is providing answers to those questions. So instead of saying, I have an idea, I know you have these pain points, this is how I will resolve the pain points, and by the way, I have this solution. I would like to work with you. the probability of you succeeding in getting the POC in return is that much more higher. Clear? You will need to do that research because that information is already available. You will need to survive the first year. You need to survive the second year. Because that's when the bulk go on. Factor in a three-step process for your one client to take a decision. Awareness is where the Google searches come in. That's what you're working on. Then comes the consideration set. Are you even a part of the consideration? As right now with your solution, you're not even a part of the consideration set. And only the last 4% get into the decision making. I'm not even talking about decision making now. I'm only requesting you to get into the awareness and consideration set. Are they aware of your solution, which is towards their pain point? Are they considering, which is where I said you have to get it in writing. Even if it's an email, yes, put that commitment in. You'll have to nudge them through. Which means you have understood the pain point that much that they are happy to work with you. Makes sense?
That's again not a binding email from the...
It is not binding. What is binding here? But a binding, something in writing is a lot better than oral. Which means he has accepted and put it through. Guys, you'll have to think like outlier marketers. I get that in writing from, let's say, the CEO. I will take that email to the plant head. I'll take that same email to somebody else. Is there a weightage or not? Instead of saying, sir, that guy said, he said, nobody's going to believe that he said, she said, because that's all bunkum.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Right? You've got something in writing, you've got to get that part done. I am thinking, whether you're students or startups, you need to get off the ground. You need to get that first client who will then pass across. Now, if some of you need, we have an ebook from my company that we have come out with, which is we've interviewed 30 global experts on referral marketing. Mail me and I'm happy to share that across with you. Phenomenal learning that you have to build the value first and then look at the sale later.
Our USP, our value proposition should be fulfilling the emotions of the customer.
Your value, exactly. For that particular buyer who you are considering at that point. You have a value proposition for the CEO. That doesn't have to be the value proposition for
the user.
Absolutely. So you need to understand the emotion for that person.
What if it turns out the other way? Suppose the product, so if the user, say, let's say, consider the army general, whom we are considering as a persona. So if this product comes through, he gets good promotions. He gets recognition in his organization.
Yes.
What if it goes down?
Which is the second point. Yeah,
so then he may have to be moved out. So his decision might get affected because he may...
Which is why you need to position it accordingly. That's why you need to understand that single client that much more. And you play on that part. You will have to factor both, sir, if you're only looking at positives. 99% of the startups fail because they forget or ignore to look at anything on the negative front.
But then it's so risky to play on to a person who is fearing. Suppose somebody is going after 6 months, he's going out of service. He didn't want to have a bad name at that point.
Beautiful example. If that guy and you know he's going to retire in 6 months, you can guarantee that that person is not going to sign. Why are you wasting your time trying to sell it to that guy? Why? He's not going to take any risk with 6 months in his service left. Right? Should you even be talking to that guy, this sheet will tell you. Right? Common sense is not at all common when it comes because we are a startup. Everybody has to buy my product. It will solve everybody's problem. It's not going to work. Right? So if you say Sundaram Fasteners, do whatever it takes according to this formula and get into Sundaram Fasteners. Which means if you're doing it as a 5-day course, guys, during the break and others, you will have to continue to talk to people in Sundaram Fasteners, so those who have left Sundaram Fasteners. Which is the last part, that in getting your customers, you will need to find out who are the influencers for that customer. Who are the influencers for that customer? Right? And if it is Sundaram Fasteners, you're not going to find those influencers on Twitter and Facebook. You'll have to devise other mechanisms. LinkedIn is a phenomenal tool. Naukri is another phenomenal tool for you to find out who's left Sundaram Fasteners. So you get an idea about it. This is all common sense, guys, but we don't do all that. Because we are technology companies. We'll only Google, we'll only try to find out. Right? You will need to detect. I call it the bell bottom principle. that in certain cases you need to go back 20 years as to how it was done, and that still works effectively. Okay, I'm going to repeat some of those aspects. How many clients do you need? You need one to validate your idea, to get the POC, to get the prototype done. I'm not going to get into market sizing because Professor JK is going to handle that part. Right? Remember the stories that I said on the goat, on Amritanjan, and on the jewelry? That is how you need to step back and figure out the market and who the customer is likely to be, and therefore the personas that will come in. Good. Influencer checklist. Learnings from 30 global experts that you're looking at. We'll be here, and I'm happy to share that across with you. That's MIC. That stands for microphone. It also stands for make it count. PravinShekar.com is my private site. Any questions so far in what we discussed today? The in-depth focus was purely on the buyer persona for a client on who are all dealing with it. And any of you have specific questions, I've already got details about your company. Do mail across questions and I'll be happy to get into an engagement.
If we start following the emotions rather than the actual needs, like emotions can differ person to person more than the needs. Needs may be more or less aligned. Emotions can differ.
How do you say that?
Let's say me and this guy, let's say we have more or less same kind of income. So we both need phone. But I may need a slightly higher end phone.
That's not a need, that's a want in that case.
Okay.
And that comes from your emotional status.
Yeah, so emotions differ, but need is same.
No. The need is for a phone. The want is different, that you want a particular phone. And that want comes from your emotion.
Yeah.
I am happy and satisfied with the feature phone, but he wants something else.
Yeah.
Right?
So, should we think more from emotional perspective or more from the rational
you
need perspective?
You fill up the sheet for one buyer persona for a problem, it becomes all that much clearer.
Okay.
Do not complicate, guys. It is as much you simplify, it is better. You try to add on all aspects of complication, it's not going to work. You pick up five people, one simple pain point across. For that simple pain point, what is the aspect emotional connects for each of these persona? Plant head's need is different. He's getting a salary. He needs to get automation, but he also needs to be shown in a good light with his boss.
Yeah.
Right? A plant manager report sent to someone else. That person's need is going to be different. Right? But both of them want automation. Right? A CEO will have budget as an issue. He might come up with the most costly part of it. The CEO is not going to say no. So then a compromise comes into play. Right?
Yeah.
Simplify, guys. When you're building business persona, when you're building a business plan, my logic is very clear. You've all written exams. If you know the answer to the question, you're going to write 2 paragraphs. If you don't, you're going to write 20 pages. Putting on everything, putting on charts? No. This is a simple one-pager. One-pager per persona inside that particular company. And it evolves. Once you do it for 5, then you can clearly map them all together. Good. Any questions?
So the Amritanjan example you gave.
Yes.
Like 1 or 2 is what you know, and that's why you go and pick it up.
Right.
So we as startups, we are all... Nobody, right? Nobody knows me. Everybody knows big people. So how do you fit this Amritanjan example in this entire thing?
Beautiful. What is the need here? That my daughter has headache and I have to get something.
Something.
Right? I have to get something from somewhere. I have to find a solution. I can take her to a doctor. I can take her to an emergency room. Right? But at the moment, I have to immediately resolve it. How do I resolve? I can give a tablet. I can give an ointment. Options are there.
Yes.
I can take her out for a walk to give her fresh air. All are my options. But I want something immediate. Right? So I asked my wife. My wife says, go get Amritanjan from that shop because that shop is the closest. The pain point is the same. But in addition, I want it resolved immediately. So because it is immediate, I'm happy to go, even if it is several kilometers away, to get that medicine and bring it back. Right? For which you need to understand, not what I am buying, but why I am buying.
Immediate requirement.
Which is what you would need to find out. Which is what I keep telling. Find the immediate pain point that you need to resolve. It has to be a single pain point, guys. You're not trying to become an anacin for everything that you want. Right? Same for you also. Don't try to sell everything. Find out the biggest pain point, get an entry. Fair enough? Good.
After the session also, so we can talk later on.
I'll be scooting off, but if you email, I'm happy to connect over a call or a Zoom call.
So just one more doubt, sir. You mentioned about the awareness stage.
Yes.
Just throw some light on the consideration stage.
Beautiful.
For something like us.
Beautiful. Now you have already arrived at what is the pain point for that buyer. How are you going to pass it across to that person? Now, is the pain point immediate? The same Amritanjan example. In the consideration set of solutions I have, going out for a fresh air, washing her face, giving her a tablet, or putting that ointment. These are the four options in front of me. Those four are in the consideration set. I need to be aware of these four. If there is a fifth element available, I'm not aware, it is not going to be a part of my decision making. Only what is there in the consideration set, I will decide amongst those four options.
In our case, will there be any consideration set?
You need to make that consideration set, which is why I said focus on one client when you are in the idea stage. Once you find out what it is, that consideration set is that writing that I asked you for. That they are aware of you and they are happy to consider you, provided it meets their norms and addresses their pain points. There are only these three stages. Professor J.K. will say IDA and few others. I would leave to his expertise there. But for this example, you will need to get into the consideration set, whether it is for a POC or a prototype.
You should know that something like this exists.
Yes.
Then only they will come to know that.
How will they know otherwise? Especially if it is a new service that we have not thought of.
Awareness is their awareness or our awareness?
Their awareness, guys. It is their pain point, their awareness. Right? So stop thinking insular. Start thinking about them. The more you think about them, you'll start...
We have to get into their minds.
Absolutely.
That's the pinpoint.
Yeah. And if you need to go meet, do a survey, you should go ahead. And I would request, don't outsource it to any company. You have to do it yourself. And preferably face to face, not over some online survey
like
that you send across.
How it works right now, it's like if they're going for some military missions, there will be one medical assistant or a doctor accompanying for a troop.
Right.
So now that assistant, that doctor has limited resources for small wounds, for gunshot, with immediate they can just do like a first aid.
Right.
Because he doesn't have all the resources, he's also in a battlefield environment.
Right.
Now if I provide a solution that I have a small base camp 50 kilometers back from that location, which has certain additional facilities, now if something happens, this guy is already aware because of my sensors that, you know,
right,
this is the damage which has happened. Now, that doctor has to otherwise call and tell him this is what went wrong.
No, your flow is right. I'm only requesting you to validate your assumption by talking to 30 such medical people.
30 such combat medical officers.
You have to talk, preferably over Zoom. Try to avoid sending a survey asking them to, because you get a lot of visual cues that you will need to make use of.
Basically validation, this is customer validation.
This is your understanding. So you've gone in with an assumption that this is the pain point. When you validate, you will realize that probably that's too low. There is something else that I need to provide a solution for. Good. Thank you, folks. I'm available on email. I've deliberately not given the phone number because I don't pick phone calls. So I'll be rushing out now, but I'm available.